I have been I'm a mathematician by training. I have been in the classroom in lots of different capacities for almost 30 years. And when I sort of left Walla Walla Community College, I was at the State Board of Community and Technical Colleges, as Monica mentioned, as a math policy associate. And just this past March, when I left the State Board, I went to Complete College America, and that's where I am now. And I am serving mostly the Pacific Northwest, although there are lots of exciting projects that sort of take me all over the country. And so I just wanna talk to you just a little bit about Complete College America, and then I wanna just jump right into Washington. So Complete College America, this is our mission statement. We're a bold national advocate for dramatically increasing college completion rates and closing institutional performance gaps. And it tells you sort of how we go about that. But the two big things are, you know, we really are interested in increasing college completions. I think that Washington in particular has been really good at looking at the questions of financial aid for students. There's been a lot of work. In fact, Washington is kind of near the top at how it meets students' tuition needs. I mean, obviously the cost of college is bigger and more complicated than that, but Washington is really near the top. And for me, one of the exciting things about Complete College America is now thinking sort of beyond what it means to get students in. And I know all of you have been doing this completion work for a long time also, but what it actually means to get students through. And then this phrase, which I hold very close and dear to my heart, is closing institutional performance gaps. This is sort of the Complete College America language around equity, right? That it is really up to the institutions to figure out how to close those gaps, right? That these are not student gaps, but institutional gaps. I just want to spend a couple of seconds here because the way our work is structured at Complete College America, we sort of work with 18 strategies that are divided up among four pillars. The pillar that I am responsible for really is the structure pillar. So math pathways, meta majors, academic maps and milestones, smart schedules, and then stackable certificates and credentials. Those are sort of my specialty areas at Complete College America. I think, you know, guided pathways is huge in the community colleges in Washington. We don't have the exact same strategies, right, as the essential practices that are in guided pathways, but there's a lot of overlap, right? I don't think that there's much surprise. It's not like this completely different formula. So for me, one of the really exciting things is we have an alliance, and up until a week and a half ago, there were 39 states and 9 sort of consortium that are sort of sections of states like Northern California and Central California and Southern California. But as of this last week, the governor, Jay Inslee, signed the agreement. And so Washington now joins those others. So Washington is now the 40th state that's part of the Complete College America Alliance. And that doesn't really change things in really significant ways about my particular, how much I care about Washington and the success, but it sort of does, it sort of formalizes a structure where we can work together, hopefully even more in the future. I do want to talk about one thing, and that is, why are we still talking about math? I mean, if it's up to me, we're always talking about math because, well, I'm a mathematician and this is the thing for me, right? I would talk about math all the time. But I think it's for some people, it feels exhausting because it feels like the higher ed, post-secondary landscape, the higher ed community is always talking about math, right? They're always talking about math. And in my opinion, there's always a lot of focus about the first thing that is on this screen, and that is increasing student completions, just making sure that we're getting more students to and through their math classes. And I totally believe that that's important. I agree that we should absolutely be talking about ways that we can increase student completions. But really, for me, that's part of a bigger picture. I also hope that we're also, while we're doing that, thinking about, you know, how do we continue to improve the student experience and make sure that the courses, that the math courses that students are taking are more meaningful, both in terms of the content, right? Like, and then also in terms of the pedagogy and grading practices, just everything about the class that intersects with the student experience is more meaningful. And then I think the thing that we also wanna make sure, and I'm hoping is it doesn't need to be a counterbalance to the increased student completions, but I do wanna make sure that we're keeping an eye on it. And that is, we are never looking for less prepared students, but instead for better prepared students. And so it doesn't mean that we need to make the courses harder or put more in it, but it does mean that we need to align it with what the students actually need to know when they leave. And so for me, this is sort of the trifecta, right? If we have better prepared students, we have a good experience for the students and they're meaningful and we can increase student completions all at the same time, then we're doing the right things. And so these are sort of my big goals. One thing that often I feel like in Washington is this elephant in the room is intermediate algebra. And I think before we go on and talk about other stuff, about what's next in Washington, I really wanna just take a minute to talk about intermediate algebra because I think it's complicated, and it's complicated in ways that sometimes need to be complicated and sometimes don't. So there are two reasons really that we talk about intermediate algebra. There's kind of a third reason. There's sort of this, I don't know, ethereal thing that like every educated person should know intermediate algebra or something. And I'm gonna just leave that out in a parking lot someplace. But the two sort of practical matters when we talk about intermediate algebra are, in Washington, there's a direct transfer agreement, right? And the direct transfer agreement says that any course that is gonna be counted as a QSR course in transfer has to have intermediate algebra content, right? Either from the high school or from the college at a 2.0 level as a prerequisite. And I just wanna sort of unpack that a little bit because it has been unpacked already. This is not something like, this isn't things we need to do in the future. This is stuff that's already been sort of discussed and decided. And so I just wanna make sure that we all understand what that means. First of all, it means intermediate algebra content. It doesn't mean that every student needs to have a course that's equivalent to Math 98 at the University of Washington or something like that. It just means that they need to have some intermediate algebra content. The Joint Transfer Council 2 years ago agreed that a co-requisite was as good as a prerequisite as long as it was transcribed separately on students' transcripts. And they agreed that it didn't need to be 5 credits worth of intermediate algebra, right? So that if a student had for the gateway math course that they were taking, if 1 credit of intermediate algebra was appropriate and you could do that in terms as a prerequisite, that was fine. All right, so that's one place, right? So that, I think that's important, right? We still believe that every student has to have some kind of algebra, but we wanna make sure that the algebra that they are studying is appropriate to their gateway math course and their program of study. The second half of the back half of the elephant in the room is admissions, right? So we've got this thing about the DTA and transfer requirements for a QSR course, but then we've also got this idea about admissions. And I don't know how many of you have heard of these CADRs before, but the Washington Student Achievement Council in Washington, which is where you would expect the Washington Student Achievement Council to be, right? They sort of put out these, they decide really to help drive the high school curriculum, they put out what are the minimum distribution requirements that a high school student needs to be able to go to a baccalaureate in the state of Washington, right? And these are their CADRs. And there is some flexibility around this, which I'm not going to get into the details too much, but basically algebra 2 is part of that, right? Like, and that's not 100% true, and there are all kinds of crazy exceptions, but basically for the CADRs, for brand new students, it's algebra 2. And for most of the baccalaureates in our state, the public baccalaureates in our state, since those CATERs were written for incoming students, right out of high school, first year students, they totally didn't affect our students coming out of the community college, right? Because our students, they didn't need these CATERs to show that they were ready for college. If they were transferring from one of our community colleges, that they had already proved that they were ready for college, right? They had come and they had taken the credits with us. And so as long as the student met the definition for a transfer student, that is, they had at least 40 transferable credits, everybody was fine, right? No, then they didn't need to go back and look at the CATERs because these were transfer students and the CATERs are written for brand new students. But at the University of Washington, up until right now, they still used what they called sort of CATER equivalent admissions requirements, right? And so every student who was going to go to the University of Washington needed to have either an Algebra 2 from high school or a course that was equivalent to the Math 98 at the University of Washington or one of the exceptions, right? In order to be admitted. It had nothing to do with the DTA. It only was an admissions requirement. And so I am sad to say that for a lot of our colleges, that was sort of a stumbling block to being able to do something really creative and interesting, especially in the statistics pathway, because they were having these students that wanted to transfer or thought they might want to transfer to the University of Washington. And so statistics was not one of the exceptions. And so they were going to have to take this intermediate algebra course as an entrance requirement. And I just want to tell you, that has all changed. Within the last few months, the University of Washington has announced that starting in winter of 2023, they no longer will be using the CATER equivalencies for transfer students. Right. And so that is really exciting because that means that now, of course, we still have to consider how intermediate algebra plays a role in our DTA, but we no longer have to think about how intermediate algebra plays a role in admissions requirements, right, for our transfer students. So I know that's probably more than anybody wanted to hear about any of that, but I do think that it's really important to sort of get that out there. And I do think that it really does help us sort of, there are plenty of other obstacles to co-requisites and some of those things. And this one was sort of an artificial obstacle. And so I just am really excited to be able to share and that is true. I just want to be really clear. That's true at all of the University of Washington campuses. So interestingly, the Seattle campus announced first, and it took a little while for the Bothell campus and Tacoma campus to announce, but now everybody has. And so the University of Washington is fully on board with that. So, yay. All right. So what I would like to do today is spend a little bit of time just talking about sort of what's sort of happening out in the country, the things that I'm seeing as I'm talking to people nationally, and use that as an opportunity for you all to sort of do a self-check. Right, about where you are with regard to some of the big initiatives that are happening in terms of math in the U.S. right now. And so really, though, this is a time for you to just think about, like, what is this something that I care about? Is this not something, or is this a big deal for us? Is this something that we've got in the bag? We've totally done this, no problem. Or is this something like, oh God, we have to think about that? Or is this something that we'd prefer never to think about? So the first thing is the right math for the right path. And I will say, I think Washington is in a really good place here, right? Like if we think about that DTA and having the five different math pathways that are, so we don't have preponderance of our students going into pre-calculus, right? They are going into whatever math is appropriate for their pathway. And I think on most of our campuses, people have had these robust conversations about which math class is appropriate for which pathway. I think there have been some stumbling blocks on the second part about students are being enrolled into the program identified gateway math course in their first year. And part of that's the first year part, but part of that is also I think this happens across the country. students end up in the wrong math class just because of how orientation and advising and placement look on their campuses. But I will say, if somebody just were going to ask me, you know, how I felt generally about the state of Washington on the right math for the right path, I would say that we're doing a pretty good job. And so I just want to take a second here, in case there's anybody on the call that sort of disagrees with that. Is there anybody that feels like this is a place where we in Washington really need to focus?
I do think one area I'm getting a lot of pushback on are like individual programs like biology. They're not happy with the Math 140 that we have right now, kind of a statistics calculus hybrid that really focuses on calculus, 6 credits, UW or WSUV has an equivalent course. But I would agree with you, Dr. Fuller.
Great. Okay. So that's a good point. So there are individual places where we may have little things happening, but on the whole, people have sort of adopted this idea of right math for the right path. I just want to throw out there something that's sort of coming down the pike that I think is going to be interesting for all of us to think about in terms of right math for the right path or right math for the path is the launch years work out of the Dana Center. I don't know how many people are familiar with the launch years work out of the Dana Center, but it's really an effort to think about this whole idea of right math for the path in the high schools, right? So this is more about math pathways for high schools, and not for making sure every single high school has math pathways, but eliminating obstacles, both sort of legal and policy and transfer obstacles for students who, high schools that want to have pathways at their high schools. And Washington was one of the three states. So Washington, Georgia, and Texas were the first three states that worked with the Dana Center on this. And I think a lot of really good conversations came out of that. And even, you know, between the three states, they really approached it very differently, but the Dana Center really got a lot of great information about that. And they just launched round two of the launch years with 20 more states. Okay, so this is now we're talking like we're getting close to critical mass here. And so I just want you to be aware of that. So if you hear those words out there, right, that this launch year stuff is going on, that you have some idea what people are talking about, right? They're talking about pathways for high school students. And I think we can all agree that's going to be like even more complicated than pathways was when we started thinking about it for post-secondary students. But that's out there. And so if you, all right. So I just want to, Helen, I saw your comment in there. I think the math for data science pathway needs attention. Do you want to just speak to that for a second? Like what do you?
Sure. And hi, everybody. And I apologize, I'm on my phone rather than my computer. This is coming up again and again at the national level. It's coming up in the state of Oregon because I think in their launch years project in Oregon in the high schools, they're kind of creating a data science pathway. And then the students hit the community college and we treat them like a STEM major and send them into Calc 1. I just think this needs some attention. We need to collaborate with the 4 years and make sure that what is exactly their requirement? And that's okay, different than computer science, and it's different than general STEM. Like it involves a stats class, but our 146 may not be adequate. So I just want to throw it out because it's coming up a lot at the national level.
Absolutely. So that's great. In fact, that was, it was data science that was a real impetus for the launch years work a long time ago, right? There were people that were people in the Silicon Valley who were really saying like, I would rather my own child, my own son or daughter be in a data science class in high school than in another class leading them toward the calculus pathway. Then there got to be some really discussion about what a high quality data science class would look like. And I do think, you know, Helen, I think that's a great point that we want to be in those discussions. We do not want to sort of see what happens and then hear about it after the fact. Make sure that we are part of those, because, you know, it's interesting when people talk about data science in the same way that when people talk about statistics. I mean, you can be talking about something really, really advanced, right, for STEM students, or you can be talking about something where you're talking about the ethics of how people use data, something that really takes very little in terms of prerequisites.
There's a really specific detail that's coming up too, and it's around linear algebra. At yeah. Highline, we allow students to take linear algebra after Calc 2, but there may be some reason for us to think about after Calc 1. Most data science people say, I can't imagine doing data science without understanding linear algebra. But if the universities aren't requiring Calc 2, then it might behoove us to modify the prerequisite for linear algebra to Calc 1.
That's a great point. And that's exactly the kind of stuff that I think we're going to need to talk to the baccalaureate partners about. All right, so moving on. Equitable enrollment. So this is something that sort of got a lot of attention. I don't think this is too surprising. There was a lot of push early on for people to think about shortening the pathway to get to non-STEM gateway math courses. And, you know, whether that was through prerequisites or shortening the prerequisite pathways, just all kinds of reform went into the shortening those paths. And that work made this real disparity, right, in how short the path was to get to non-STEM versus getting to STEM math at some colleges. Certainly not across the board, but that certainly was the case. And so then what they started seeing was that even though there were more students getting to and through their non-STEM courses, right, they were not seeing that, they were seeing some real brand new equity gaps happening even in the STEM, which already had bad equity gaps, right? And so really thinking about looking at your disaggregated enrollment data, really analyzing that to identify who's enrolling in which programs. And if there are things on your campus that are acting as obstacles for some student populations to enrolling and completing programs of study, right, that lead to high paying careers. And I just want to go sort of one step further beyond, because those performance gaps existed before and now they have been exacerbated. I just want to argue that really, if you're going to be at the front of this, if you're going to be at the tip of the spear, you're not just looking at what obstacles exist, right? But you're looking at which ways have you proactively looked at different communities and made sure that they feel like they belong in certain programs of study. And, you know, whether that's really learning from some of the activities of STEM Corps or some of the other incredible things that there are colleges in our state that are focused on, I would say that right now, this is something where I would say that our success has been kind of lukewarm, right? We acknowledge that there are some things, we've noticed that there are some gaps, but I think there's been a lot of sort of like shoulders up, okay, but now what do I do about it, right? Like, okay, I see that, but the students aren't ready, the students aren't ready, or if the students aren't interested, the students aren't interested. And there's been, and it's hard, right? It's hard to invest in getting students to be inspired to do the hard work to complete some of these programs of study. And so I'd like to just take a quick pause. Do people feel like this is a place where we are wildly successful, or is this a place where we need some more work, or how do we feel about this in Washington? Warren, did you want to say something? Nope.
I'm still too new to Washington to make comments on some of these things.
Okay, that's great. So I'm just going to tell you again, this is just me from, okay. So I'm seeing a couple of people in the chat. Yeah. I think this is a place with the, sorry, I'm trying to catch this. Can I elaborate more on such equity gaps still being detected despite shortening the math pipeline to non-STEM pathway? So, I just want to make sure I'm talking about the right thing here. So which gap? The gap in which students are successful in the non-STEM pathways, or which students get placed into the who enroll in the non-STEM pathways? Yeah, so both. I don't think it's any big surprise to anybody on this call that there are structural things that that have a disparate impact on certain student populations. And I think that we have done a really good job at identifying some of those things, like these really long pathways, these some crazy things that happen in placement, all kinds of stuff. But I think we've been a little bit nervous sometimes to really break through the classroom door, right? To think about what the role is of what happens in an individual classroom with course design and with how a faculty interacts with their students, and how that affects things. And if you're really going to think about implementing things with as equity strategies and not just crossing your fingers and hoping that there's good equity because it's good practice, that you have to be willing to see what's happening past the classroom door. So there, that part I think explains a lot about why there continue to be these gaps, even though we have done a lot of structural things to help in the non-STEM pathway. This thing about enrollment in different programs and who gets enrolled in different programs, to me, that part is much more complicated. And I will say, I think part of that is that we don't have equity in aspiration. And so because when a student comes to us, we ask them what they want to do and we show them what their choices are and then they choose. If there is a gap in what their aspirations are to begin with, then that gap then perpetuates on through whatever they're doing. And so to me, the places that have really, pushed against that are the places who have really focused on purpose, right? Why is the student in college? What do they really want to do? Some exploratory stuff early on. And that stuff is really hard. And it's the thing if you look at some of the really specific things, like at STEM Core, where they're giving students access to explore through hands-on experiences. If you look at some of the relationships like the Eastern Washington communities have with PNNL, the national labs, getting students and seeing some of these things. I think that's where, right? I think you have to really, you do have to just, it starts with aspiration. So Robert, I hear you on NEIR, and I would like to argue that you have a lot of comrades on the call and moving on. all right. This one is hard for me. I think one of the things that we have done a really good job of when we looked at sort of math pathways is thinking about what students need sort of generically for the programs that are internal to us. And one of the things that happens then, if they go on to a baccalaureate partner, depending on what their program of study is, it may turn out that the courses that we're offering don't actually align. So when Robert was mentioning earlier about this really specific thing at WSU Vancouver, right? Is that where you were talking about? Yeah, like where you really have thought through, okay, what classes do we have on our campus that are gonna count and how are they gonna count at our transfer partners? I think this is probably one of the hardest problems for me to think about, because you absolutely have to have the baccalaureate folks in the room, right? This is not a, in the same way that, you know, our high schools can't solve the problems without coming and talking to us about admissions requirements and placement requirements, right? We can't solve the transfer problems without also talking to our baccalaureate partners. And I don't think it's too surprising that those baccalaureate partners are not twins, right? or not triplets or whatever, septuplets, right? So what Central Washington is going to think is really important, and what the University of Washington are going to think is really important for a student that's going into psychology, right, even within the same program, might be really different. And so this is one of those issues that is coming up nationally, where people are looking at really specific, I mean, there's a lot of grant money going into this right now, people trying to figure out how to solve the transfer problem. And the transfer problem where you're not losing credits, where you're not retaking courses. And I would just like to offer that the math piece of the transfer problem is a big piece of the transfer problem. And I'm not really, I'm not offering a whole lot of solutions, except to say, when opportunities come, this is a place that there's often going to be some funding for, right? So if this is something that you really care about, if there's a project you can imagine there, that this is something just nationally, it's a hot button issue right now. All right, I how many people have ever heard me talk about co-requisite support courses? Probably none of you, right? But you know, this is one of the things that I think is so interesting. And that is, the more we learn about co-requisite support courses, the better they look. And I think this is so funny, because any of you who have had this conversation with me, I was really skeptical. As a mathematician myself, I came in and I said, listen, all you're trying to do is shorten this pathway. All you're trying to do is eliminate content. All you're trying to do is make it easier for students. Co-requisite courses, that's fine if all you're trying to do is increase completions, but it's not doing the other two things of increasing the quality of experience and making students more prepared. And that's just not been what I have found. Now, with that said, I will say that although there's no one right way to do co-requisite support courses, I will argue that there are some wrong ways to do co-requisite support courses. And one of those is, if your support course has too many credits, right, then it becomes completely untenable, for example, for part-time students. And let's face it, we're in community colleges where 3/4 of our students are part-time students. Right. So we have to think about sort of those kinds of issues. But, you know, in the same way that we talked about things before, in terms of, you know, having good structure is important, but it's not enough. I think that what we're finding, I was at a wonderful meeting over the summer this year, where sort of some of the biggest heavy hitters in the country who were doing co-requisite work, both at the state policy level and right into the classroom level, were together, and we're talking about it. And we're really having this same sort of, you know, come to Jesus moment, right? That if we don't figure out what's happening in the classroom, all this structural stuff is great and it's better than it was before, and it's not enough. And so I also want to just, I've made this nod here, you know, if I think about sort of co-requisite courses as being the gold standard, I want to acknowledge, if you, for example, have math for elementary teachers on your campus, right, and you're offering it one time a year, one section with 18 students, it may not be financially feasible, right? It's just not realistic for you to develop a co-requisite support course, right, for math for elementary teachers. Or similarly, if for whatever reason on your campus, these things they don't work out that way. And so I say, I think we're starting to see nationally that people have really started to think in those sort of, I'm going to call them fringe cases, although I know that they're not that fringe for some colleges, but in those fringe cases, what are some other appropriate supports? What are some good ways that we can actually support students in those classes? And even if we have co-requisite supports, what are we missing? What are the things that are not, that we're not able to do in a co-requisite support course that we're going to need to do like outside? And one of my examples for this is, for those of you who have had students in pre-college math courses or developmental math courses or whatever they were called on your campus, a lot of things happen in those classes that have nothing to do with preparing the students for the mathematics that's coming next, right? Those are the places where the students figure out how to be students. They're the places where a lot of the issues of life, right, are sort of fed. And so there's this real concern that if you eliminate those things and replace with a co-requisite support course, that you have lost something. And I would argue that it's true, you have. But what I would also argue is you find a way to replace that that is not tied up in a math class, right? That what we are doing by tying all of those things up in those prerequisite courses is neither serving students well, nor frankly, serving us well, right? As math faculty, it means we will be the perennial bad guy, right? Like, so I'm arguing for us to give ourselves a break here, right? But I do think that as people have started really thinking about basic needs support, for example, and college readiness support as actual strategies that we need to focus on our campuses and looking at tactics for ways that those strategies can be implemented that are completely separate from this idea of the standalone pre-college math and English courses, people have learned a lot of stuff, right? They've learned a lot about how to find out what students need and how they don't. So I just want to just right now, I'm going to ask everybody to sort of just really quickly write in the chat. If you think your college is exactly where you would want it to be ever and in the future with co-requisite math courses, I'd like you to just throw the number 10. And if you think, man, we are bazillions of miles from where I would like us to be, if you could just throw in the chat a 0. And I just am kind of curious about sort of where you see yourselves right now on that. Dan Taylor, I that -1 is 2, 8, 4, 3. Okay, so these really, I think this is all over the map, right? Which is exactly what I would have guessed. And so that feels like to me there's some opportunity here, right? There's some opportunity to keep going. And the nice thing about this, about co-requisites as opposed to transfer, is the body of knowledge about how to do co-requisite support courses well is huge, right? This is actually, it's not any easier of a problem, but the body of research and the body of understanding about this is so much bigger that we're gonna be better equipped to make progress here. All right, so I know this is a phrase that I use all the time and it makes some people really like kind of twitchy, but this idea of defaulting to college level, right now on some of our campuses, you're practically here. But for other campuses, it really is. Well,
before, can I ask a question before you go on? What's your sense of the overall like success of co-requisite programs? How do you think co-requisites are doing as a whole?
In Washington or in the country?
In Washington.
I would say that in Washington, I don't know. I will say, maybe not unrelated to Robert's comment earlier, I think it's really, I haven't seen good data. I've seen good data at individual colleges. I should be really careful about that. And in those places, But then it's really hard to see how much of that success it's tied up with exactly the model they're using, exactly the people that they're doing things, you know, that, that are doing things, as opposed to sort of a more umbrella view about where things are going. And there are so many colleges, and part of that comes from how we collect data in the state of Washington, which I'm just not going to get too far down that particular rabbit hole. But part of it comes with, we didn't in the beginning, you know, we wanted everybody to try things, right? To see what would work. And that's awesome. And I'm really glad. And I don't think that co-requisites would have gone anywhere in Washington if we hadn't done that. But because of that, we don't have any sort of standard ways that we code things. We don't have standard course numberings around co-requisites. Like, even the courses that we have common course numbering for the gateway course, we don't have common course numbering for the co-requisite course. We don't have common placements into those courses. We don't have common outcomes for those courses. And so I think it's just really hard. And look, COVID hasn't just messed with your data, right? It's messed with your students, but
and with ourselves.
Of course.
Right.
But I will say this. I will say, nationally, every time I'm sort of ready for the next study to come out and think, okay, this one's not going to be as good, it's just as good as the early numbers were. And like, so let's just be really clear. There are some states that do not have the same kind of faculty unions. And so they do things at a state level in ways that we can't or won't or shouldn't or can't or whatever in Washington, right? And I do think in those states, it's just easier to make some sort of global decisions and have people implement. I will say the things that are interesting to me about those are that they, you know, they have good success, right? And so there is a real question about at what point does this sort of groundswell of people trying to do things, you know, when does the productiveness of that stop and the need for policy start? And I always would rather have policy not come into it, because I think that you're often, you have this big hammer trying to put in like a little tack, and I don't think that serves us terribly well, but I do think that that's one of the things we're seeing. I will say one of the more interesting things that came out for me within the last 6 months is a study that came out of Florida. And the thing that was interesting about that was basically there was a lot of questions about, can we just support them in different ways, right? And so they were doing all these different supports. So co-requisites were one, they were doing these sort of emporium style supports and others, embedded tutorings, they were doing all these other supports, and overwhelmingly co-requisites served students better. And I, you know, it's one state. I don't want to model Washington on Florida in so many ways, but the data sort, it's pretty big, right? And it's also really, really clear coming out of that data.
Agreed.
So
thanks.
I think Georgia really is the only place where I have seen them really close the institutional performance gaps with co-requisites, though. I will say a lot of states, what's happened is, you know, everybody goes up, everybody, all across all the demographics, everybody goes up. But that just means that this institutional performance gap window goes up with them.
Sure.
And I'm not really sure what happened that was different in Georgia, but man, they went like this. I mean, it's just amazing how they closed. Granted, I want to just be careful when I talk about that data in Georgia and when I talk about that data in Florida, it's really quantitative data, right? So it's really about student completions. And it doesn't deal with those other things that sort of, I think we all think about as part of our student success initiative. So, but right now it's still looking really strong.
That's great. I have a follow-up if you...
Please.
One of the strengths of Shoreline, I think, is the relationship between the math department and our basic skills,
AB
folks. Do you have data or experience of somebody looking at the importance of that relationship and how it affects success in co-requisite models, or do you have experience in
I don't, although I will say, I mean, yeah, so I don't have data.
Okay.
But I will say, just having been in, when I was working with colleges in Washington, you can talk to them about what's working and what's not working. And if those people are part of the conversation from the very beginning, everything feels smoother, right? So I don't know about like data in terms of completions being better, but I can just tell you in terms of what it feels like on the campus, and what it feels like for students to understand where they're going, and that sense of belonging and that sense of just sort of clarity. I think it's hard to argue, right? And I don't know if you know, Dawn is on the call. I thought I saw her from Lower Columbia, who also has an exceptionally good relationship with their basic skills, and how that has really just made things smoother for students.
Right, it certainly matches my experience at Shoreline.
Yeah, so that has certainly been what I saw. I will say, I do want to just touch on basic skills for just a second. One of the things that's interesting to me is a lot of the states that we're looking at their data, they don't have basic skills. And so it's kind of an interesting thing because it means that all of their data are students who already have a high school credential, right? And so, but it also means that they were never tempted to take students that previously would have been in a standalone pre-college math course and just put them into sort of an equivalent basic skills course over here, right? Like, and so I do think that, but I think that's, it's always an interesting thing to think about because not every state has that, the kind of basic skills, and not every state funds it the same way. Yeah.
Can I jump in here, Laura? I just want to add to the conversation. So in my previous work, I was in our basic education for adults department here at the state board. And this has been a conversation that actually we have been having just this week around how are we supporting colleges with these conversations, bringing basic skills and math departments together. We have some targeted professional development that we are working with Don Drouse and Katie, I can't remember Katie's last name right now, which is rude, but they're both from Lower Columbia College, and working with them on some PD really to bring books together, but then also around the question of, you know, what does basic ed collaboration and co-requisites look like? I don't think we really have a model to draw from. And something that's exciting about Washington is that we sometimes take some risks, and we have some great, that has paid off well for us in the past, especially in thinking about our groundbreaking work with iBEST. So having just such committed partners in the state board together and knowing that, that those partnerships are mirrored and or ready to be mirrored on your college campuses is something that we are really looking forward to. So more to come, but this is front and center for us.
Thank you. So I'm gonna sort of shift gears here just a little bit. So I think this is one of the things that gives people the most pause, this phrase that I have on the screen right now, and that is that the default enrollment for every student with a high school credential is into a gateway math course or beyond. And this to me is, this is one of those places that I think that we're not here yet in the state of Washington. And I'm not even sure how many people we have on the call that think that this is where we should end up. I do wanna say, so there's a question in the chat about what I mean by gateway math. So I wanna just parse this whole thing a little bit. So I will get to that. First of all, I wanna talk about what default enrollment means. By default, right now, our students, they default into, for lack of a better, on a lot of our campuses, they default into the lowest course. And then once they give you enough evidence, either by taking a test or showing you a transcript or going through some process, they can move their way up, right? But sort of what this proposes is that you default to the gateway math course. And I'll talk about what that means. And then if something happens, if they show you that there are some exceptional circumstances, they spent 25 years in solitary confinement, or, you know, whatever, right? Like, there are exceptional circumstances that perhaps this is no longer the appropriate course for them. And the Gateway Math course, I'm talking about across the five pathways in Washington, and then also the philosophy, but 120 or equivalent. But so the Math 107, the Math in Society, whichever one of the two tracks you have, if you have it at your college, for the math for elementary teachers, the 146, or introductory statistics or equivalent, the 140 or pre-calculus equivalent, and if you have a special college algebra for business or finite math course. So that's the five sort of entry level. So it's sort of the first college level course in one of the five transfer pathways, right? That's what I mean when I talk about a gateway course. Obviously there will be students that took calculus in high school that are gonna start even beyond that. And also I just wanna say, the enrollment into that gateway math course, right, would assume, right, that the student, it has access to these other things, right, that there are co-requisite supports or other supports, because otherwise, if you're just putting every student or defaulting every student into a gateway math course or beyond, then you're back down to like 1978 or 1980, where we had this national right to fail. Right, where you just put every student in, and then, you know, hopefully they just did whatever they had to, and if they weren't ready, they weren't ready. And I don't think anybody, I really hope, I don't think anybody is interested in going back to that. I will just say this particular statement for the states that have really gone to scale with co-requisites, their idea of going to scale with co-requisites means having this as your default enrollment, right? They're going to scale with co-requisites. What that means is they have developed co-requisites or supports for every college level gateway course, so that any student with a high school credential, and by any, there are always going to be exceptions, but where the default for a student with a high school credential is for them to start in the gateway math course with all of these supports, right? Whichever supports are appropriate for them. And so I have a request in the chat, and I'm going to honor that request. So Sally, I think I just wanna make sure, if I mess it up, please let me know. So I think Sally, the idea is that not where we are right now, but where we should end up. So a zero, oh, no way. This isn't even close to where we should end up. And a 10 is, yeah, I mean, it's gonna be hard because we're gonna need to develop all these supports, and we're gonna have to do a lot of work, but that's the North Star. That's what we should be aiming for. That's where we wanna get to. And so I'm willing to do that poll right now. So if you could just take a second and write in the chat, just, and this is, obviously, we're not holding you to this, right? This is just sort of how you're feeling about it. All right, so I think clearly not everybody voted, but I think one of the interesting things that's on there is the incredible spread of those numbers, right? The people who, right, we have plenty of people that are up at the sort of 9 and 10, and there's people down at the 3. Like, really, they're not convinced, right, that this should even be something that we're aiming for. And I would just like to say that this, to me, is just really tightly related to this idea of co-requisites of workforces, right? That if you're going to have this be your default to college level, you're going to have fully developed all those other things. Okay. So now, I think for me, again, this is sort of the next step along that defaulting to college level. I think about, so if we're going to default to college level, then what does placement even mean? And I know there are people on this call, there are people nationally who don't like the word placement. And I'm telling you, I'm using it anyway, because when you start calling it other things, people have no idea what we're talking about. And so I'm using it. But you know, I really think that just philosophically, thinking about whether or not your placement process is about sorting students or figuring out what supports they need, right? That's a very different approach. And I will say that people that have gone for defaulting to college level, if you're defaulting to college level, there's still this piece of sorting, right? Because you're still deciding whether or not, for example, let's say a student is interested in STEM, you've decided that they want to do that, right? Do they start in pre-calc one or pre-calc two or calc one or calc two or linear algebra, or like where are they starting along that route? But I think that the real thing that's interesting is the number of places that are really, you know, we went from everybody took a test, right? And then we went to multiple measures, right? So now we have all these different measures where people are trying, but the idea philosophically was still the same. We're still trying to figure out which students should be in which levels. And then when colleges started really eliminating all of those standalone pre-college math courses, then this idea of sorting really, it sort of lost its teeth, right? Because now you're just determining which supports a student needs to be successful. Like, so if the student is going to enroll in statistics, that's the course that they need for their plan of their program of study. They need statistics. That's their gateway math course. If you already know that they're going to enroll in statistics, then it's a matter of figuring out, well, what else do they need? What do they need if they're going to be successful in that class? Do they need the co-requisite support course? Do they need, do they need some help with housing security? Do they need embedded tutoring? Do they need really some help figuring out what it means to be a college student, right? Those things we were talking about before, all those sort of, those other skills, like what are the things, they need. And I think one of the things for me is when we stop needing to work so hard at figuring out sort of where along the vertical path they are, it gives us the space to really think about where along the horizontal, right? Do they belong in statistics or do they belong in Math 107? And how is that related to what they really want to do when they're done, right? What kinds of questions could we be asking them as part of this process to really help them identify what their goals are, right? To really work on that idea of increasing their ambition, for example, and then making sure that we have identified for them which class is appropriate, right? Which pathway is appropriate. And then what are all the things that we offer on campus? Because I will say one of the things that's so amazing was amazing to me when I visited the 34 campuses or the 34 colleges in Washington was, how many people have mountains of supports for students, right? They have tutoring centers. They have supplementary instructions. They have MESA centers. They have private tutors through their TRIO program. They have food banks. They have mental health counseling. They have so many supports, right? And all of those are going to be necessary, not all of them for every student, right? But all of those things are, you're going to have to really plug in students to all of these different things that you offer and figure out what other things you need to offer if they're going to be successful students. And that's whether they're in intermediate algebra or elementary algebra or in statistics, right? Like wherever they are, they're going to need all of those. We're going to need to figure out what things they need. And really thinking about transforming your placement process into one of figuring out how to support students and not how to sort students, I think that's a really hard philosophical change. And I also think it's important. And scale up existing supports to be available to everyone who needs them and not just people that know about them. That's exactly right. Like there's this huge communication piece. And sorry, Sarah, it took me a minute. I realized I missed yours.
I basically am just trying to ask if, I mean, right now we seem to be advising these students sort of in silos. I'm the math instructor. I do as you say, I look to see whether they have met prerequisites, and then I have a small conversation about whether they are heading to the right math class because that should have been done with their advisor or their parents or their self-reflection or whatever. And I'm simply there to look to see if they have the skills based on what little evidence I can find, and then put them into a math class and hope that it all works out. It seems to me that to do what I actually believe you're saying should be done is that students should start with the college level course that's appropriate for what they think they want to follow, with or without support. That we need more than just a math advisor. We need like a mentor for each student, or a coach, or a guide, because that person wouldn't just help them decide whether, okay, it's been 7 years since you've had a math course, so I recommend that based on what you've said, you take statistics with CoRec support. I think that they would benefit from having someone decide if the statistics course was even right for what they think they want to study. And that is well beyond my training.
Yeah, I mean, so Robert, I see your hand. So I just want to acknowledge this really quickly, and then I'll come back to you. I mean, I think two things are right. Like, so one of the things, granted, you know, you can't do everything at once, right? And I do think that one of the really hard parts is sort of what do you do first? And how do you make sure that you keep moving along? And I think part of that is identifying where you'd like to end up. And so for me, that's part of this, is just sort of thinking philosophically about where you want to end up and whether you're doing the things to get there. Because I think that you're exactly right. Like, you know, whether that means really thinking about 360 degree coaching for students, whether that, you know, what is advising look like? What does orientation look like? You know, what does a first year experience course look like? But I also want to just come back to something else. You know, I think that when students, so I want to acknowledge that the STEM pathway is different. And I want to acknowledge it because even if the student starts in pre-calculus one, right, they're still taking math every quarter to get that AAS, right? Like, and so those students really have different needs, okay? But I will say, if there's an example of a student that is pretty obviously not STEM, right, has let you know that this is not, and by STEM, I shouldn't even say that, but is not in one of these sort of algebra intensive pathways that lead to calculus. Because they could be nursing and be STEM, depending on how you define it or whatever, right? But so if a student is not in that get me to calculus and get me through the calculus sequence pathway, right? So if they're thinking AA or AS as opposed to the AAS, or maybe I have the letters mixed up, but you know, if we are defaulting to the college level course with supports, it doesn't have to be the first quarter, right? Because now, instead of saying we need you to get through these four math classes, we only need you to get through one, right? And if we only need you to get through one, and the goal is to get you through that in the first year, right? You could actually adjust things where there was actually some time, not just with, you know, the fastest advising appointment known to mankind, because it's 3 days before the quarter starts in the fall, and you just got to get them enrolled in some classes, and everybody needs to take math from the beginning, and so you're going to get them into this math class. You could actually spend some time with students who aren't sure about where they're going and what the appropriate math course is for their pathway, doing some of that exploratory stuff in the first quarter, and then starting in the winter, right, or starting even in the spring with their math course. And I think just really acknowledging that, you know, that yeah, we might have to rethink a lot of it, is important. So, all right, so I'm gonna go backwards here, sorry. Sherry Ann, my philosophical dilemma here is between guided self-placement concepts and pushing people into required prerequisites. I love both concepts, but don't know how to mesh the two in a way that doesn't counteract the other. You know, the thing about required prerequisites that's kind of a funny thing is I think my angst about required co-requisites decreases with the, as the number of credits for that required co-requisite decreases, right? If it's a 5-credit co-requisite, then requiring students to do that gives me a lot of angst. If it's a 1-credit co-requisite, I have very little angst, right? And so I think that those are, you know, those things are play into that. But I agree, there's a how much do you accept students? And I do think that that's one thing about pushing things to the winter, to the second quarter, where students have a chance to really understand what those math courses can sometimes for students be really helpful. And then Jennifer Lawson, the IBEST model offers the support. Students get a mentor to help them through their classes and make sure they are on the right path. You know, I think that for particular programs that have the full IBEST model around it, I think that's absolutely right. And it's true that, you know, that Washington was a leader in IBEST, right? We have continued to be. All right, Robert, I know I keep talking, sorry. Your hands up.
Yeah, no worries, no. I love hearing you talk about these issues. I mean, in a similar way, right, we are providing a lot of these support services, you know, the food banks, the, you know, counseling, all this stuff because of a decrease in support from the state and in federal, you know, loans. And I think we all saw the FAFSA numbers of how many people actually, you know, submitted their FAFSA. And it feels that we're in a similar place with co-recs of, you know, we're trying to plug holes of trying to get students this intermediate algebra content for STEM majors, right? You know, in the co-rec. And I just have a lot of faculty who are still, you know, looking at our two classes of pre-college math for STEM majors and saying, you know, there's no way we can take someone in that first class and put them in a co-rec for you know, algebra. At Clark College in Vancouver, Washington, we do the college algebra and the college trigonometry, not the pre-cal 1, pre-cal 2, everyone else does for reasons. But I just have a lot of that resistance right now. And our co-recs, I think, are doing okay, but it's just really, it's hard thinking about lowering that placement and what additional supports they would need when there's so much need for that algebra. And I will say, I feel like we're a victim of our own kind of choices here, right? Like we have focused computation over analysis and over so many other things that we're kind of stuck now in a place where we have to do computation, right? We have to factor quadratics every freaking day, right? Like it just feels like we've put ourselves in this place that we can't seem to get out of.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a good point. So there's a lot of good points there, but I do think that one of the things to just think about there is, you know, ideally when you're doing co-recs, and I think everybody here in addition to streamlining pre-recs has done this, right? You do this backwards design, right? You start with where you want to end up and then you sort of work backwards. And for some people that were as part of that, the pre-calculus work with me before, when I was still at the State Board, right? We did it at the level of calculus. We started at calculus and then sort of went back what really needs to be in the college algebra or the pre-calculus courses. But yeah, I think that you're exactly right. Like, okay, so are we teaching the right content in those courses, right? And assuming the answer is yes, what's really necessary for those. And in reality, you know, what can we do in a co-requisite? How much can we actually skill up students in a co-requisite? And I think that there's not a simple answer to that question. And I think that I think that there are going to be students for whom the answer is too much. There's too much for us to try to skill up in a co-requisite. But I just want to be really careful, right? That when you imagine that one student for whom that won't work for, when you look at the data about how many students the pre-college sequence is not looking for, is not working for, I just want to make sure those people are just as visible to you, right? It's just as visible to you how many students are not being served by what we're doing right now, right? Because it is true that there will be students for whom the co-requisite is not perfect. But I'm telling you right now, there are a lot of students who are not being served by this prerequisite sequence either, and thinking about sort of why that is. Carrie, I think that's actually true. I feel like not just about prerequisites, but about teaching in general, right? And what does course design mean when you have these incredibly diverse courses? And I will also say that's a place where we all are sort of first generation equity practitioners, right? We're figuring some stuff out, right? But we have a long way to go. But I will say that people are working on it, and I would hope that we are too. All right. So now that I feel like we've kind of done like a huge self-assessment, we're going to go into breakout rooms, and it's going to be really short, right? We're just going to go there for 10 minutes. And I'll tell you the reason that we're going to go into these breakout rooms is what I really want you to do. So really a quick intro. Hi, this is who I am. This is who I am on my campus. If you can think of one thing that your campus is doing really well, that's awesome. You can share that, but obviously be aware of time. And then what are you most interested in working on, right, to continue and increase student success in math? So like, we're really interested in just really thinking about how to change placement from sorting to supporting, or we're really interested in developing those supports other than co-requisites, or we're really interested in developing co-requisites for all of our pathways, or whatever, or something completely different. So what are you most interested in working on to continue to increase student success in math? And so the tiny URL that I'm gonna try to put in the chat, it's just a slide deck. And so what I just am gonna ask is for you to look at your breakout room number and then just go and try to, if you have any notes, to just put them in that slide deck. And so, like I said, we're just gonna go for 10 minutes out. It's gonna go by really fast. But a chance for you to just to at least meet with a few other people that are on the call. And so, Ashley, are we ready?
Yes, it will automatically be moving people into rooms.
Perfect. Woo-hoo. All right. So, welcome back. I just want to tell you, I love watching the Google slides from my end, right? Where I can just watch them all getting filled in. It's funny because as I'm reading through some of the great things that are happening on people's campuses, most of the time I'm saying, yep, they sure are. They're doing that. That's awesome. But I appreciate sort of having them in one place. And I will tell you that part of that is for really selfish reasons, because now that I am at Complete College America, now that I often have a national stage, it is not uncommon for us to look for good examples, right? To share with other people, to let other people know some things. And so it's exciting for me to now be able to think about when topics come up, how I might be able to sort of use my megaphone and shout out some things that are happening already in Washington. And then the second question really was about you sharing what it is that you think you might want to work on, because, you know, like we sort of mentioned earlier in this call, like there's just so much to do, right? There's just so much to do, and we can't do everything first, and we can't do all the things at once. And there is no right or wrong order, right? I mean, okay, there are some wrong orders, but there's no, right? Like, so if you want to say, okay, you know what? We need to just stop with the structure for a few minutes because we have advisors that are actually dressing in black and waiting outside of our houses at night with baseball bats because we keep changing things and they can't keep up, then maybe it's time to work on some really great professional development toward pedagogy or course design, right? Or maybe it's at a place where you feel like, man, we keep running into the same problem with students being in the wrong classes or are not being able to, and we have got to work on the structure, or we've got to work on something else. I do appreciate that you can't do everything at once, and that really the goal is to just keep moving forward. I love how people in Washington, that, you know, when everything, every like cell in your body wants to just hit that pause button, just keeps going anyway. And how awesome that is for the students in the state of Washington. And so we only have 2 minutes left. I just want to tell you that I'm going to leave that, I'm going to change that URL into where you can just read so that people don't go in and edit and delete other people's, but I am going to leave it open as a read in case you were so busy looking at what you put on your own slide, you didn't get a chance to see what other people put on theirs. But I also just want to offer that I'm at Complete College America. One of the things that we are able to do because we have this sort of national presence is we're able to sometimes attract funders that it's harder for individual colleges to attract. And so if there are sort of things that you're really interested in working on and we can somehow put together a bigger cohort, whether it's a cohort of colleges in Washington, a cohort of colleges in Washington and Oregon, or Washington, Oregon, Idaho, Montana, because I just want to tell you, like, every one of these states are working on a lot of the same problems. That there may be some ways that we can sort of partner together to really find ways to do funding that's differently. And that's one of the reasons that I'm just so excited that Washington's now part of our official alliance, because it makes all of those things sort of doable for us through Complete College America. If at any point you have a great idea, I hope you'll share it with me. I will be sharing the slide deck with Ashley and Monica and over at the Student Success Center. So my contact information will be in there. I hope that you found some things to think about today that are exciting for you. And I just wanna thank you all for being here.
Thank you. Thank you so much for leading this conversation. It is so important for thinking about our next steps. So I want to invite folks to unmute and say thank you if you'd like.
Thank you, Laura.
Thank you, Laura.
Thank you.
Thank you, Laura.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Monica.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
you.
Thanks.
Oh, Francis.
So thank you so much, everyone, for being here. And I hope you enjoy the rest of your Wednesday. We will be following up with